Welcome, everybody. The first thing I have to do to tell you is to I have to apologize myself for my English. It is not perfect, of course.
We are all used
just
to
in Italian, so English is very different. So we can start with this tour for a taste of Italy with Dr. Wine. And the first sample, the first wine, is a wine from Campania. It's a white wine, so it's impossible to make mistake. Is the sample number one, of course, and is a Vesuvio Caprettone, DOC. It's a 2019. It's a very strange wine because comes from a real native variety. The Caprettone, you know, some of you knows Italian, and so I know Italian, and Capra in Italian is the goat, and the Caprettone is the native variety that remember us that probably the goat like the grapes, probably. But the Caprettone is very, very typical for the Vesuvio area. Vesuvio is a volcano, of course, is a volcano of Naples. You know, all the landscape of Naples with the volcano. And the Vesuvio, on the border of the Vesuvio, there are many vineyards, and some of them are grown with the Caprettone variety. And the Caprettone is similar to the Greco, to the Fiano, for example, but with some little differences. This wine is has been aged in amphora and in tonneau, so for 6 months. Of course, the micro oxygenation is due to the amphora and to the tonneau. The color, as you can see, is a light gold color. And the nose is a little fermentative with some touch of medlar, probably. But the fruit is not the only character of the sense of this wine. There is also some part that comes from the fermentation and come from the aging in amphora, first of all. That is a little complex, not only fruit. And the taste is a good taste because the acidity is like a salty acidity, not an acid acidity, you know? Like the Mediterranean white wines. In the Mediterranean white wines, the salt character, the salty character, is more evident than the acid character. You can have this kind of taste in the Greco, for example, in some white wines from the south, but in the Mediterranean wines it's very evident. You know, also in some French wines, in the Châteauneuf du Pape Blanc, for example, or in the white wine from the coast of Spain. There are the character of the salty acidity, I call these as a salty acidity, not an acid acidity. A good body and a warm final in this wine. I think that should be Massimo Setaro that is in contact with us. Then
he's online
and if he wants, he can add something about the winery. It is Casa Setaro. It's very interesting winery in the Vesuvio area. And that is not Irpinia, is not the peninsula of Sorrento. It's a particular area very close to Naples, on the south of Naples. It's a very ancient area for history because around the Vesuvio mountain, the Vesuvio Vulcano, the ancient Roman grown vineyards 2,000 years ago. And now they are restarting in the last 20 years, and they are making very interesting wines, different from Irpinia and different from the wines of Peninsula Sorrentina and from Ischia, for example. So I don't know, is there Massimo Setaro? Okay, yes. You want to add something about your wine and the winery?
Okay, yes. Good morning, good evening, and thank you for giving me this opportunity, and nice meeting you all, buddy. I apologize for my bad English, but we'll see in the future, we will learn a bit much more. So I am the owner at Spade, but I am a winemaker. I'm a farmer that inherited the vineyard from my parents, and my goal was to don't abandon the land, to keep in mind the effort that my parents made to have to stay a long time the vineyard. So my purpose was, my goal was to be sure that the heredity was keeping in touch, was keep it as good as possible. So now we have 16 hectares along the slopes of Mount Vesuvius, facing Capri Island, just close to Pompeii ruins or Sorrento as big. As well. My philosophy is to preserve the nature, to respect nature, and in fact we are a biological winery, but also to preserve as well as possible the history. And we have our vineyards are without American roots, so we have only.
Massimo Setaro, unfortunately, we have only 45 minutes for 9 wines.
Yes, so. No, just this thing. So we have also Prefilossera grape. A lot of my plants are Prefilossera. Yes. All the vineyards are without American roots, just to be sure that we do not filter with our land.
Probably a lot of you knows this, but the Prefilloxera vineyards are very, very common in all the area around Vesuvio and in Campi Flegrei on the north of Naples. There are the majority of the vineyards are Prefilloxera, so no grafting with the American roots. The original vineyards, and probably the Caprettone is one of the most ancient varieties we have in Italy at the moment. So the name of the wine is Ariete. This is the bottle and the label. It's a very nice blue label, and the design of the Ariete on the label, because Caprettone and Ariete. Now we can go on, and the second wine is from another volcano, from Etna. So the starting is a volcanic, very pyrotechnic beginning. And the second wine is a rosé wine, is an Etna rosato, Le sabbie dell'Etna, that means the sands of Etna, is by Firiato. It's 2019, from Nerello Mascalese, that is the red varieties of the Etna area. We are in Sicily, of course, and we are in the northern part of the Etna region. In Verzella, little town, in the area of Castiglione di Sicilia, because the Firiato, they have a great winery in the western part of Sicily, in Paceco, that is close to Trapani, in the western part. But from 5-6 years, they have also another winery in the northern part of Etna, so in the eastern part of Sicily. In the more continental part of Sicily, because the weather on Etna is very different from the other part of Sicily. The vineyards are from 400 to 1,000 meters on the sea level, and the weather is colder than you can imagine. So the wine from Etna are very, very high in acidity normally, and the white wine in particular, the Carigante, but also some red wines and some rosé wines. This is a vinification in rosé, and the varietal is Nerello Mascalese, 100%. No wood, no barrels, only steel, and the color is, you remember, the cipolla di Tropea, the skin of the onions, of the Vidalia onions, the Tropea onions. And the nose is fermentative, is not so fruity, the nose of this wine. There is some complexity, probably some flint in the nose, more than fruity scents. So, and this is a character of the wine from the rosé wine, but also the white wine from Etna. Some white wine from Carigante, remember me, some Riesling, for example. This is a rosé, of course, so no Riesling, but some note of flint in the nose is evident. The acidity is evident too. The character is an acid character in this wine, refreshing, easy to drink. It's a classic rosé from Etna. Firiato is one of the most important and most famous winery in Sicily, like others, of course, but Firiato in the last 20 years was one of the most important, most famous winery in Sicily, and they produce a lot of wine. This is probably one of the simpler among the wines of Firiato, but it's not the worst, of course, because it's very easy to drink, it's very refreshing, and I like very much. I like the rosé wine from Etna because they represent a style in the world of the rosé wines, and you know they are in this moment very famous in all over the world. Not in Italy, not for the Italian rosé, but for example the Provence rosé or the white Zinfandel are very popular in, all over the world in the States. First, but also in other part of the world. And this was the second wine, the Etna, northern part of the region, Nerello Mascalese, no wood and very easy to drink, in my opinion. The third wine is from Lombardy, that is the region of Milan. It's a southern part of Lombardy, is from Castello di Cigognola. Cigognola is a little town, and the Castello di Cigognola dominates the landscape of the little town of Cigognola. It's very vertical castle. And the owner is the Moratti family, Gabriele Moratti. And the Moratti family is very famous in Italy for some reasons. The first is that Angelo Moratti was the owner of the Inter Soccer Club. The Inter of Milan is one of the most important soccer club in Italy, no? And was very famous for that. The now the owner is the nephew of Angelo Moratti, and the Castello di Cigognola is a fantastic winery in Oltre Po Pavese, so in the southern part of Lombardy. Hill everywhere is not flat land, Oltre Po Pavese, is very hilly. It's like Lange, it's very similar to the Lange as landscape. And this is the Barberasso. It's a Barbera from provincia di Pavia, that is the IGT, the indication, typical indication, geographical indication. It's from Barbera. Barbera, of course, you know very well what is Barbera. But the harvest was made in two different periods. The first period to have acidity, and the second period with a little late harvest to have body of this wine. This wine is 2018. There is no, there is some wood in aging, but not much. And we have probably between 8 and 12 months in different kind of barrels. The color is the classic color of Barbera, so it's a little is red, deep red, but with some part violet, purple in the color. The nose is a classic nose of the Barbera, is very varietal. So red fruit, of course, some spicy scents, and probably black cherries, that is a classic scent of any Barbera, probably. But probably the taste could be very interesting in this wine, because the relationships between acidity and body, it's very, very interesting. There is a little sugar residual, 8 grams for liters, but come si dice? Combinato, well balanced with the other part of the wine, so it's not too sweet for a Barbera, and the acidity is evident, as the Barbera has to be, must be, because the Barbera is very famous for the acidity, first of all. So I think there is someone from
Firiato. There is from Federico, are you online? Here he is.
Federico Lombardo.
Here I am. Good afternoon, everyone.
Okay, let's come back for a moment to Firiato and to the Etna, Le Sabbie dell'Etna 2019. And if you want to add something, you are free to do.
Oh, thank you. So, what to say? I think that the rosé wine from the Etna Volcano, it has a very particular shape. In my opinion, I think that Nerello Mascalese is one of the, we can say that it's perfect to make good quality rosé wine. Just to give you an idea, in the other regions, the rosé wines comes from second choosing grapes. On the Etna, the tradition is not like that. Is to select the correct grapes to have rosé wines. Now we decided, when we started to challenge rosé wine on the Etna, one of the last wine we decided to produce, just to give you an idea. We started with the red and white at the beginning of the 90s, and then we started to make traditional method sparkling wine with Nerello Mascalese. Then after that, we decided to challenge the rosé. So we create a mix and match between the agronomic practice for sparkling wine and the vinification in rosé. So the idea was to make the agronomic practice in vine growing using the practice of sparkling, traditional method sparkling wine. So you produce high production for Nerello Mascalese. Then you have an harvest that is a little bit early than usually you harvest the Nerello Mascalese for red wine. And then soft pressing, no more than 2 hours of contact with the skin for to have this color, you say, the onion of Tropea. Okay, yeah. Yes, yes, the onion, the onion of Tropea. It's correct, absolutely correct. And because our objective was to maintain a good acidity, a good concentration of malic acid, so freshness, but at the same time, the markers of Nerello Mascalese. So I think this is my opinion. This is a vertical wine. You can taste it and say, okay, I'm sure this is a rosé wine from Nerello Mascalese.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're
and
welcome.
Now, is of course the representative of Castello di Cigognola, that is Alberto Zucchifrua.
Ciao Alberto.
Hi. And please Alberto, add something about the Barberasso. There is no sound.
No sound.
I don't know why.
No.
There
seems
is no
to have a problem.
Problem for the sound, Alberto. I don't know. Okay.
Tu riesci a mettere l'audio per Alberto?
Adesso non probabilmente.
È lui che non funziona.
It's a problem of your.
Maybe.
Okay.
Oh,
okay.
Now here we are.
Okay. Very good. It has been difficult, but okay. Nice. Hi, guys. Hello, everyone. It's a pleasure being with us. I'll be fast. Barberasso, it's a new project for us. It's something quite new also for the region, because Oltre Papavese never tried to do something in what we've studied before. It was Ripasso style. So we've decided to trying the cutting of the branch directly in the vineyards, allowing the grapes to have a nice and slow drying. And this concept is mixed with the normal harvest of Barbera, so preserving acidity, freshness, and all the things that the young Barbera has. The result, it's very, I always think that this is a nice and easy drinking wine. It's a wine for everyone. It's a wine that every time I let him try to summon friends, clients, all of them are always like, oh my God, what is this? It's something different. Never heard about this kind of Barbera. And this is what makes me happy, makes us happy about it. It's something nice, something that it's a new project, but we like it.
I think that the residual of sugar is not a problem for this wine, because the acidity balance very well the wine.
Yes, of course. This is thanks to, let's say, the DNA of Barbera. Barbera has a nice acidity, and that these characteristics allowed us to have a little sugar residual, 7.5 grams per litro. So it's not that much, but it's something.
Yes.
So it's a nice, at the end, it's a nice balance, and it's a very nice result. So we're happy about it.
Thank you, Alberto. And let's go on.
Thank you.
Wine number four. And the wine number four is not far from Castello di Cigognola, because we are in the very close area, but in another region. Castello di Cigognola is in Lombardy, and now we go to Piacenza, to the Colli Piacentini, that are in Emilia, Romagna, in Emilia, not Romagna. Emilia-Romagna is one region, but divided, shared in two different parts, very, very, I don't know, they fight one against another, because they feel themselves as independent. So the Emilia is a thing, and Romagna another thing. And in the Gutturnio Superiore, DOC, Gutturnio is the denomination of the most important denomination of the Piacenza area. It's a 50%, 55% Barbera and 45% Croatina, that is another name for the Bonarda. So it's very similar with the blend that we have in Oltre Papavese. One year in barrels, not new, not all new, and the wine, it's a typical wine of this part of Italy, of the Piacenza Hills. The color is deep, concentrated, as you can see, because the Croatina has a lot of color, and so give colors to the blend, to the wine. Like a Syrah, like a, I don't know, a Petit Verdot, for example. The nose. The nose is spicy and fruity at the same time. Probably some vanilla from the barrels come out in the nose. Yes, in the nose. And but a lot of black fruits, a lot of sunflower in the nose also. But spicy, very spicy. You can feel a good relation between tannins and acidity. And this is very, I don't know, fun, because the acidity, as you know, helps the saliva, the salivation, and the tannins not, the contrary, on the opposite. So this kind of thing make a complexity in the taste, in my opinion. So you have salivation and not salivation, and this is funny to taste this one. Very warm, we have probably 15 degrees, so a big red wine in alcohol, 15, so it's not few. It's a good final, in my opinion, very warm, very very long on the palate. And this is not a very famous area for big red wines, because Piacenza is known for the sparkling, for some sparkling, also some white sparkling wine with a name very strange and difficult to pronounce. It is the Ortrugo. Probably in English it's impossible to pronounce the word Ortrugo. But this wine is from Barbera and Bonarda, so it's very easy to pronounce. A big red wine with the big food of Piacenza. They make fantastic dish of meat, red meat, especially.
They have good cuts that are very good.
And the salamis.
Salamis over too, there are wonderful.
It's one of the most important plates for the salami, and the Oltre Po Pavese too. Brownie, it's very, very important for that. And this was the number four. I have to go fast because we have no a lot of time. The wine number five. The wine number five is a Pinot Noir. For Italy, the Pinot Noir is not so common, because we have Pinot Noir, of course. But normally, the Pinot Noir, of course, it's Burgundy. It's Central Otago in New Zealand. It's Oregon. Italy, after, no, in the consideration of a lot of experts, this is one of the best Pinot Noir that we produce, because it's Cantina di Merano in Alto Adige. So we are in the north of Italy, in close to the border with Austria, and a lot of people speak German in Alto Adige, Südtirol. There are two languages in Alto Adige, Italian, three languages, in fact, Italian, German, and the Ladin, that is a very ancient language from the mountain, from the Alps. And in Switzerland, in Friuli Venezia Giulia, in the northern part of Veneto, they speak this kind of strange and very ancient language that is probably the most the closer language with the ancient Latin, the Latin with a D, not Latin with a T. And this is the Blauburgunder. Blauburgunder is the name, German name of the Pinot Noir. Blauburgunder Reserva, 2017. 2017 was a warm vintage, very hot vintage in large part of Italy, not so warm, not so hot in Sud Tirol, in Alto Adige. And this is from this wine, this Blauburgunder Pinot Noir, is made by Cantina of Meran. Meran, Kellerei Genossenschaft in German, that is it's a cooperative cellar. A cooperative cellar. In Alto Adige, there are probably the best cooperative of all Italy. And Cantina di Merano is on the northwestern part of the sub-region Alto Adige. Very warm area, but not warm for the Pinot Noir, because the vineyards of the Pinot Noir are in altitude. So we are close to 400, 500 meters on the sea level.
There is a question.
Yes.
From Lana. Lana, can you hear me? Yes. Well, anyway, she put a question regarding the Bonarda.
Yes.
Is the Bonarda related to the one in Argentina?
I don't know if because there are many, many clones of Bonarda and two different varietals of Bonarda. One is the Bonarda from Oltre Po Pavese. The second is Bonarda Novarese. The Bonarda from Oltre Po Pavese is called also Croatina, and it's very dark. The Bonarda Novarese is from Novara, that is the northern part of Piedmont, is lighter than Bonarda of Oltre Po Pavese. Probably is a single name for two different varietals.
Okay.
So, and I don't know which kind of Bonarda they make in Argentina.
Okay.
Probably the Bonarda Novarese, because a lot of people from Piedmont went to Argentina in the first decades of the 20th century. So probably they make more Bonarda Novarese than this kind of Bonarda. The Bonarda from Piacenza is the same of the Bonarda from Oltre Po, it's very close.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Let's come back to the Blauburgunder. Blauburgunder is the name of the Pinot Noir. The color is a color of Pinot Noir, and the nose is very fruity and light spicy. It's very varietal as a Pinot Noir. The wine aged for 1 year in different kind of barrels. Mostly in little barrels, in barrique, and other part in big barrique, the tonneau. So, spicy, the wild strawberry, classic sense of Pinot Noir. And, you know, it's not a navy wine. The tannins are velvety and the acidity is good. It's not too much wood, in my opinion. And it's one of the most of the best example of Pinot Noir we make in Sud Tirol. They make in Sud Tirol, of course. I don't make wine. But in my opinion, it's a good chance for the Italian Pinot Noir because it's not heavy, it's elegant, a good length in on the palate, and the relation with the tannins is not too aggressive, so the tannins are balanced by the other part of the other components of the wine. And the persistence is not bad in this wine. I like very much this wine. It was one of the best of this year for our little guide. And we gave a good score to this Blauburgunder, Zeno, the name, Zeno. And 14 degrees, but I don't feel too much alcohol in the balance of the wine. It's a little warm in the final part of the tasting, of course, but not too heavy. And this is important for a Pinot Noir that lives with elegance. And this is a good example, in my opinion. I don't know if there is something by Cantina di Merano, by Merana Cremarai.
Maybe, Bill Haid, would you like to add something as you work with Cantina di Merano? Bill?
I just started working with them. Okay. I was introduced to them by the people at St. Michael Eppin, San Michele Appiano.
Okay.
Yes.
And Gunther there is good friends with Manfred, and Gunther asked me to help Merano in the market because they weren't here. And we're just starting with them. There's a gentleman that's online right now, Marcello Miali,
uh-huh.
who owns Wine Icons in New York and New Jersey. He's going to be starting with them shortly. He already received samples. He's going forward, but I have not visited the cantina. I have seen it. I've seen the brochures and stuff, but I haven't been out of Texas in well over a year now. So my next trip to Alto Adige, I'm sure I'll be there. But I spoke to Manfred a few times.
No, it's a fantastic winery, and they are most famous for the red varieties than the white varieties,
mm-hmm.
for
mm-hmm.
example. San Michele Appiano is the opposite. Is most yes. famous for the white varieties, for the Sauvignon, for the white Burgunder.
Yeah.
Then they make also a good Pinot Noir, of course, the Anstetzer. But Merana, it's very famous for the red varieties, Pinot Noir, but also Cabernet.
For example.
They make a big Cabernet, very, very interesting. Let's go on. Thank you, Bill. Let's go on and go to a very historical winery. We are in Tuscany, in Mercatale. And Mercatale is on the not far from San Casciano, Val di Pesa, and not far from Greve in Chianti, in the northern part of the area of Chianti Classico. And this is the Chianti Classico Gran Selezione, that is the Super Reserve, the Great Selection, 2016 by Villa Le Corti, owned by Principe Corsini. Principe Corsini was one of the most important noble family in Tuscany. And the tradition of the wine making is, I don't know, is old or from several centuries. And the Villa Le Corti is a splendid place in the middle of the hills, on the south of Florence. And it's an incredible place. This is a 2016 that in Chianti Classico is one of the best vintage of the last 20 years, probably. And this is the Don Tommaso. Don Tommaso is a great selection, is the best Chianti Classico of the Principe Corsini. It's 80% Sangiovese and 20% Merlot. 1 year in Tonneau, 16 months exactly, in Tonneau, 500 liters and 700 liters, so not only the normal Tonneau, but also the bigger Tonneau. Very, very good for the Sangiovese, better than any Barrique, for example, because the Sangiovese, Giulio Gambelli, that was a great winemaker, said that the Sangiovese will like to rest in big beds, so prefer the big bottle, the big barrels to the barrique. And we are in the middle because this is a Sangiovese with a good body and good structure. So, Don Tommaso 2016 by Principe Corsini, organic wine. And the color is a classic color of a Chianti Classico, so the touch of Merlot probably gives some color to the Sangiovese. The nose is fruity and very integral. It's very
intact
in the nose. The fruit is evident, and in my opinion, elegant. It's a good vintage, really good vintage, 2016. and the acidity. It's a good acidity. The tannins are evident because of the wine is still very young in this moment. But this is the profile of a Chianti Classico or from Mercatale. You know, the vineyards of Corsini are very close to the vineyards of Tignanello, for example. They are very close because there is, Tignanello too is in Mercatale, the hill of Tignanello. And the style of Corsini is a more traditional style than the style of some wine from Antinori, for example. And the difference is in that. So the Corsini is the real tradition of the Chianti Classico, and the one of the more ancient owner of vineyards in the history of the Chianti area, of the entire Chianti area. So when we talk about Corsini family and Corsini wines, we talk something about history of Italian wines. I don't know if Duccio Corsini or something or someone is online or
someone
or
from
not.
Yes.
Yes. Gianluca. Ciao.
Ciao.
Ciao, ben okay. Arrivato.
Grazie. Welcome.
So talk about Corsini family and Corsini. Let's
it's a lot of history.
Yes, I mean in terms of size of the company, I would say we still are a boutique winery, even if the name belongs to a very important family for the history of the city of Florence. We own two wineries, one in Chianti Classico, the other one in Maremma. And this one in Chianti Classico was bought by the Corsini family in the 1363. So this property was bought mainly for the extra virgin olive oil production that we still have, but also for the vineyards on the side. We are no exception to the Italian viticulture. So we have olive trees and on the side, the vineyards. Right now we have 48 hectares planted with vineyards. We do organic farming of the vines and also of the olive trees. We try hard to be as sustainable as possible. Of course, we farm mainly Sangiovese, and we also have a small part of the vineyards dedicated to Merlot farming and to Colorino, which is a grape that we use for the Chianti Classico Annata, for example.
Okay. And yes. The Colorino gives the color, of course.
Yes, it's basically used for the color, but it's never by itself because it's not very interesting as other grapes. So it's very hard to find a wine made only of Colorino.
But the landscape you have on your back are the...
The landscape is a picture of one of our vineyards.
Yeah. So it's
real, but it's fake. It's both.
Okay.
It's an incredible place, Villa Le Corti, really. It's when will be possible
to travel again.
To travel again, it's a good thing to go to visit the Villa Le Corti because it's a fantastic place. So thank you, Gianluca.
Thank you.
And let's go on and go to the Lazio region. Lazio region on the border with Umbria, because we are very close to the border with Umbria in the northern part of Lazio. And we have a wine that became an iconic wine in the central part of Italy, because it's a Montiano by Cotarella family, and by Riccardo Cotarella, and now by Dominga and Marta and Enrica Cotarella, that are nowadays the owners, the young owners, all women, young owners of the Cotarella family winery. The Montiano is made of Merlot. It's strange to have Merlot in Lazio, probably, but it's not so uncommon. Because there is a strange tradition between Umbria, the southern part of Umbria, and the northern part of Lazio, for the Merlot. It's incredible. In Amelia, for example, that is in southern part of Umbria, in Spello, they grow Merlot from 1 century, probably. And in Castelli Romani and in some part of the northern part of Lazio, there is some Merlot in the vineyards. So it's not only Pomerol, it's not only some part of the New World Merlot, but also in this part of the central Italy. And probably because also this part of central Italy is a kind of new world for the Italian wine. This is a Merlot, and the vineyards are in two different areas. The area of Montefiascone. Montefiascone is close to the Lake of Bolsena. It's a volcanic lake in the northern part of Lazio, not far from the border with Umbria and with Tuscany. It's one of the biggest lake in Italy, nothing in comparison with the great lakes of USA, of course. Well, for us, a little lake, it's a big lake, because Italy is little and we have not so many big lakes. No? In Montefiascone and Castiglione in Teverina. Castiglione in Teverina is very close to the Tevere River, that is the river of Rome. And so in 100 kilometers on the north of Rome, the Tevere is under the little town of Castiglione in Teverina. We are in Lazio and the Montiano is a Merlot. Riccardo Cotarella, Riccardo Enrenzo, started to make Montiano in 1993 and then in 1994 officially. So this is 2017. This is the 22nd, 23rd edition of Montiano. So it's a little classic wine for the central part of Italy. Not for Tuscany, of course, but for the other part of Italy, 23rd harvest are not so few, not so little. One year in French oak barrel, new. 2017, a big vintage, but in this part of Lazio and in the southern part of Umbria is a little fresher than in other parts of Italy. So the 2017 was not so so hot like in other part of Italy, especially in the southern part of Italy, not only. The color is a classic color of a big Merlot, so intense and concentrated. The nose, the nose is the fruit of Merlot, the framboise, come si dice lampone in raspberry, and spicy, of course, because of barrels, because of the character of the wine. And the relations between body, the alcohol and the tannins are very interesting. 15 degrees, so not few. But we are in the central part of Italy, so the sun shines for a long time, and the grapes can mature for perfectly. A big wine, and probably 2017 is one of the best vintage of Montiano in the last 10 years, in my opinion. I don't know, Mr. Becky Sue, if it's closed now because I have a big bottle, and I can't make a comparison with your samples in this moment. So in my glass is not closed, so the fruit is very, very
and
evident.
Also, you served a while ago, so by oxygenation that came along with.
Yeah, probably, you know, when you bottle in little bottles, put some azoto.
Azoto, I don't know. Nitrogen.
Nitrogen to preserve the wine. and probably the nitrogen is a heavy gas, and so it takes some time to evaporate, you know, to go away. Probably this could be the little problem if you have a problem. So there is Emanuele Gastel with us, and he can tell something, can tell us something about Famiglia Cotarella and Falesco.
Thank you, Mr. Cernili. Thank you very much. So, you know, Famiglia Cotarella is a company that is living in this moment a very intense renaissance. I would say the second renaissance, pretty much, because Montiano, the wine that you're tasting, is a wine that is born from a challenge, a very important challenge that was started in the 90s when Dr. Riccardo, who was making wines in Montefiascone, of course, he was very dedicated to his land and to Montefiascone. But obviously, he had deep in his heart the wheel, and he really wanted to make Montefiascone not only a place for table winemaking, but to make it a famous winemaking place and to make Lazio a famous winemaking region. His talent was soon noted by the international press, and he was invited to a trip in Bordeaux. And during a chat with a producer in Saint-Emilion, he was caught by surprise when this producer decided to donate to him some the starting of a vine of his particular clones of Merlot. So Dr. Riccardo tried to plant this particular clone of Merlot over his Trebbiano vines in Montefiascone, and very short after, I think it was the third vintage that Montiano was rated above 95 points. So it immediately showed that Merlot had a great potential. As Mr. Cernili was saying, Montiano was started around the Bolsena Lake, which is actually the largest volcanic lake in Europe. So imagine this very beautiful landscape, almost paradisiac. If you look from Montefiascone, especially, Montefiascone has this particular chapel, very artistic, as everything in Italy. Every village that you discover has something really, really beautiful to say. But so the family started experimenting. Ecco, Montiano is the result of many, many years of experimentation. So the family started to experiment on these particular Merlot clones and expanded these Merlot clones up until Castiglione in Teverina. And in the succeeding of the years, the quality increased a lot, but, and this is why I said it has been through two renaissance. In 2016, when the Cotarella sisters, the daughters of Dr. Renzo and Dr. Riccardo, took over control of the winery, they wanted to do more. They wanted Montiano not only to be an important Italian Merlot, but to be an important international Merlot. So out of the 35 hectares of Merlot, they decided to cut a very small selection, just the really best lot, the really best vineyards, and to elevate Montiano even more. In fact, everyone who knows Montiano knows that up until 2015, even the label and the wine was a little bit less concentrated, was a little bit less selected, while from 2015, it has made a complete an evolution, I would say an evolution according to the sisters' will to make it an international Merlot. So today we produce no more than 30,000 bottles per year of Montiano. And of course, we have this new, very creative label that talks about the big work that has been done behind it. I don't know how much time I have left, but I can say that it's fruit of a very long work of selection.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. You changed also the label, because the label now is two colors, not only one.
Yes, it's loyal to the original label. The central logo is the one from the original, but the color is improved.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And let's go to the eighth wine, to Abruzzo. Abruzzo.
And Giulia is with us.
Ah, Giulia is with us, but I want to give some idea about the Montepulciano d'Abruzzo, DOC, the Tony 2017 by Cataldi Madonna. Cataldi Madonna is the Baron Cataldi Madonna, Luigi Cataldi Madonna, professor of philosophy, not only baron and wine grower, of course, but also professor in the University of Philosophy, Moral Philosophy. And Luigi Cataldi Madonna owns one of the most important and most famous winery in Abruzzi. Di Cataldi Madonna, of course, in Ofena. Ofena is in the middle of Abruzzi, in the very hilly and area, in the middle between, not far from the Maiella mountain, that is one of the highest and highest mountain of the Apennini chains of mountain. And Montepulciano, you know, it's a big varietal. A big variety in all the central eastern part of Italy, in Abruzzi especially, but also in the southern part of Marche, in the northern part of Puglia, for example. And Montepulciano is one of the late variety to mature. So the harvest of the Montepulciano could be also in the last part of October, in the beginning of November sometimes. So with the snow on the bunches, it's incredible sometimes. And Ofena is one of the colder area of the Abruzzi, not everywhere, but because in Ofena there are also hot areas. But normally for the white varieties, they put the vineyards in the coldest area. And in the for the Montepulciano needs sun and calore and the temperature. Mm-hmm. So the color of this wine is very, very intense, concentrated, because the Montepulciano has this character. So the nose is in Italy we have a tradition to put the black cherries with the white distilled and macerate the black cherries in white distilled. And the nose of this wine remembers me this kind of black cherries with the spirit of Kirsch, for example, the liquor of Kirsch. Some part is a leather, is another particular character of the Montepulciano. The alcohol is not bad, because we are 14 and a half degrees of alcohol. 2017 is a good vintage for the Montepulciano, and let's taste this wine. This is a real Italian wine. So when you think about imagine an Italian wine, probably imagine this wine that is a little, I don't know, the tannins are not so velvety, but very tasty, very intense. A good body. It's a Mediterranean red wine. A big wine. I like very much this kind of wine because it's so typical. One year in French oak barrels, but you don't feel any spicy that comes from the wood, in my opinion. It's more important the fruit and the typical scents of the Montepulciano that are very evident. It's a big red wine. Probably it's more typical than elegant, but the Montepulciano has this kind of character. If you taste the best Montepulciano, this is the character of the Montepulciano. So it's a wine that needs a matching with the food, for example. And for us, it's a tradition to put the wine with the food. It's not as in UK, for example, they drink with no food very, very often. For us, it's impossible to imagine to drink wine with no food for the Italians. But for the Spanish too, and the Southern French, the same. It's a Mediterranean tradition. It's not only Italian. But we want something to eat when we drink wine. So Julia, do you want to add something about you make also some great white wines in Ofena, the Super Giulia Pecorino is fantastic.
Eh? Yeah, I think
what about the Tony and what about Cataldi Madonna Winery?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Cennilli. We are a historical winery. We have 101 years old, but we are dynamics, so we like the experimentation. The vintage 27 of Tony is a new vintage. So until 2015, Tony was aging in barrique. In 26, we didn't make Tony for a spring frost. And in 27, Tony aging in a French big oak barrel. Why? Simply because since more or less 10 years, we have reduced the use of oak to point the drinkability. So I hope that you have enjoyed this new version of Tony.
Thank you, Julia. Questions by Becky Sue. What foods are typical to eat with these Montepulciano wines? But the lamb, in Abruzzo, the lamb is a religion. It's not a food, the lamb. So roasted lamb is perfect with the Montepulciano. Not only Bordeaux with the roasted lamb. Also Montepulciano. The last wine was a great surprise for me last year because it's a brand new winery with taken a great tradition because I can Domenico Spinelli can explain better than me. But this is a Primitivo. Primitivo, it's a new deal, we can say, for the Italian wines in this last period, because the Primitivo has a great success all over the world. And this is one of the best Primitivo I tasted last year, simply. It's fantastic. It's not a Primitivo di Manduria as a DOC, but in fact is a Primitivo di Manduria because they produce this wine in the area, no, not in Manduria, in Gioia del Colle, excuse me, in the area of Gioia del Colle. And for the moment, this is a Puglia Primitivo IGT. The name is Hypnotico and Hypnotic, 2018. And the vineyards are incredible because they are small vineyards, the Gobelet vineyards, 60 years old, some of them before the drafting, so prefiloxa, some of them, and they produce 40 quintals for hectares, so we have a real low production. They put in a French oak barrel for 12 aged in stainless for 12 months and 4 months in French oak barrels. And the reason for what I was surprised was the integrity of the scents. It's difficult to have a wine with 15 more than 15 degrees. With the fruit so evident, so clean in the nose, and it's difficult to obtain. And the black cherry is fantastic in this wine. The spicy is on the landscape, on the backstage of the nose of this wine, and. And the acidity. It's fantastic for a wine with this body. Primitivo in Italian, prima is before. So the primitivo, the name, comes from the reason that is the first grapes that mature. So is the first, and then there is Negro Amaro, then there is other cepage, other varieties from Apulia. But primitivo is the first. It's like the you can pick the primitivo at the end of August, for example. The beginning of September, in the area of Murge, that is a hilly area, a windy area, it's a little colder than in Manduria, that is close to Taranto, and a less altitude. So in the area of Gioia del Colle and the area of in which the Ipnotico has been produced, the wind and the weather is a little colder. We are in the middle of Mediterranean, of course, so colder is it's not colder as in other part of Europe, of course, because we are in the south, and we are in the middle of two different seas, because we have the Ionian seas between Calabria and Apulia, and the Adriatic seas on between Apulia and Albania and Greece. So we are in the middle of the Apulia region. But this wine is also a dream of two persons, of two people, Domenico Spinelli and Laura Leonzi. They both are here, and they can explain us something about the Ipnotico by Terre dei Vaz, and who was Vaz.
Thanks, Daniele, for your kind invitation, and thanks to all for the attention dedicated to our wine. So Miguel Vaz was a banker, a Jewish converted to the Christianism, and he restored, he consolidated the budget of the King of Naples. The King of Naples gave to him as a benefit a big piece of land in central Puglia, from Mola di Bari to San Donato, inside of Terra d'Otranto. But the heart of this piece of land is the Murge. The Murge is a plateau, is emerging land coming from the Mesozoic era. So the terroir is a carbonate, and it's submitted to strong temperature excursion. Strong excursion during the summer. So in May, we can have 37, 39 degrees, and during the night, 5 or 7. So, but let me just say something about our project. So Terre dei Vaz is a renaissance or a revamping of my family tradition. Me and my wife, Luisa, we decided in 2015 to revamp a very long tradition. My family bottled the first primitivo bottle in 1847, because my family came from the Balkans to populate the small town established by Miguel Vaz. This small town was called Casavaz, now it's called San Michele di Bari. It's upper on the hill of Murge. So our tradition is strongly influenced by Portuguese Sephardic tradition and Balkans tradition. So that's why our primitivo is unique in terms of terroir and process. In fact, we have still now in my cellar, my family winery, bottles still drinkable coming from the last century. So that's why we decide to start from this tradition and to replot this tradition in a new way. We do DNA research. We found the historical DNA of Primitivo, and we produce around 37 33,000 bottles per year, and Hypnotico is our top product, and we strongly believe in this product. And on the label, we try to quote all this tradition, and we call Hypnotico, and we quote the combination between the Zohar, so the Jewish tradition, and the Christianism. So there is a cross inside. So we want to celebrate this strong tradition. Now we are just starting to approach the American market, and we are so so happy to share with you our story, to share with you our fragrances, our flavors. And inside this bottle, there are many rise and fall, many challenges, but now we are just at the beginning.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Domenico. It's a big wine. It's a big wine, really. In Italy, it's one of the best Primitivo I ever tasted, in my opinion.
It's amazing.
It's not... I have no doubt about that. We are
some more questions
in the end of our tasting. Alberto Negri was from Cantine Romagnoli, the producer of the Gutturnio, the wine number 4, and he didn't.
A little late.
So,
do you want to add something?
But in Piacenza, you are really on time.
Yeah, I think your presentation was quite complete, actually. So, thank you very much. And just to introduce, Cantine Romagnoli is a quite historical winery in the Piacenza region. We were founded in 1857. And then starting from the 70s, we were the first in the area to produce also a Metodo Classico Spumante. And we are trying to work both now.
The name is Il Pigro. Il Pigro is the lazy boy. No?
Yeah, exactly. So we are now trying to develop both some innovation in our winery, and bringing also like the tradition with the Gutturnio and not very well known, in our opinion, not known enough for their quality wine that we have here in Piacenza, like Orprugo, Gutturnio, as well as some more international and more innovative technique. So this is okay. Our effort.
Thank you very much. We are at the end of our tasting. I don't know if you have
some more questions,
because we.
No,
I was very fast, but 1 hour and something.
I have a question.
Please.
Ciao, Lana.
I have a question. So, you know, we all know that Italy has this vast library of grapes, you know, more than 400 varieties, and some of them are still being discovered. As a collection of these, which are grapes that mostly, you know, we know and maybe some we don't, how do you feel this represents the the variety and the diversity and of Italy and kind of the direction that Italy is going for consumers?
Ha detto che ci sono tutte queste varietà che sono molto diverse, che sì, so che in Italia moltissime varietà, ma come pensi che queste varietà in quale direzione sta andando l'Italia e i consumatori italiani?
So every region, every part of Italy drinks their own wines. So their own wines. If you go to Turin, they drink Piedmontese mostly. If you go to Piacenza, a lot of people drink wine from Piacenza. If you go to Naples, they drink Fiano, Greco, and Falanghina, of course. And the in the restaurants is the same all over the world. If you are from an Italian chef from Naples, for example, in your wine list, the wine list of the restaurant, there are many wine from Campania. We have 500 different official different varieties. So 500 is a lot, is biodiversity, of course, and it is important. In every little town of Italy, you can find the different wine. So we are artisanal point of view, is an artisanal point of view, not a big companies that makes only Chardonnay, Sauvignon, Merlot, and so on. Sometimes at Sangiovese and Barbera, and we can find also in California or in Australia, they begin to grow Italian varieties. So this means that they like the wine likes and the varieties are popular. Huh? So, and I think that is point of view, and the situation in Italy is difficult to imagine something different. There are some positive things and some negative things, because not all over the world they know all the 500 different varieties. But in some nations, in some states, I understood that they consider the varieties as brands. So the name of the wine or the name of the varieties is the same. It's a Primitivo, but could be I don't know, Antinori, or could be, it's the same. No, it's a Pinot Grigio. It's not Italian, native Italian, of course, but nobody knows. And the Pinot Grigio is a brand. The Prosecco is a brand. It's not only the name of a wine, like champagne. Champagne is a brand, in fact. No? So it's not only Moët Chandon, Le Clicquot, or Salon, or Paul Barat. I don't know. It's a brand, and so probably in the for a lot of people that are not so inside the wine world, they know something, but they want only a glass of good wine. It's an Italian, it's a Primitivo, it's not. Then there is, of course, for Barbaresco, there is Gaia, Giacosa, and for Primitivo, there is Terre di Vazze, some other producer, and for Chianti Classico, there is Villa dei Corti. So, this is the difference between probably the Italian situation and the situation of other producers. In Australia, I think they have, I don't know, 20, 25 different varieties, for example. No? But in Italy, we have 500. It's difficult, of course. But this is our tradition, our situation. So it's difficult to change everything, to cut the varieties. So
if I can add a little something. I recently have been talking to some of the producers during this epidemic COVID situation. And I asked them how they felt the sales went. Now, this is very interesting. Very few complained that there were no sales. But what they said is that the sales were from local people coming to their own local wineries. So it's like, Lana, coming back to your question, it's like if all of a sudden people are kind of discovering again their own wines, their own varietals, the ones that they grow next to their door, you know, and they underestimated them, let's say, because it was maybe more chic going in another part, or more sophisticated, it sounded, to get the wine from somewhere else. But now, due to COVID, they didn't have much of a choice. So they had to go, if they wanted to drink some wine and couldn't go to a supermarket, they went to the winery that was there. By tasting the wines, it was interesting because the producer really told me that they got only one bottle the first time. The second time they went back, they got three bottles. By the third time, finally, they felt a little more secure. And they started to buy more wine and tasting different wines. So it's going to be something, this epidemic is really, it's like if it's changing a little bit the attitude of the consumers. I hope this helps, Lana, with the question.
Yeah. No, that is really interesting because, you know, in the United States, mm-hmm. all we hear about is that, you know, the market is very bad between, you know, COVID and sales are down and the tariffs, you know, that were imposed.
Yes, of course. Here.
But it's nice to hear this, you know, that people are rediscovering, you know, their own wines, in fact.
I was fascinated by this because I'm saying people are living next door and all of a sudden going there, you know, visiting and even visiting just for the fun of it. It's very fascinating, this kind of attitude. And I was very worried for some of them that they would have too many problems. And they've been able to hold on tight to the situation, thanks to this rediscovery. Okay, some more questions? By the way, if I can ask, just raise your hands. I'm going to put the registration on YouTube. Is that okay?
Charles,
we don't hear. Better?
Open the microphone.
Open Charles. The microphone.
Yes.
There you are.
No.
No.
We don't.
Hey.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
No,
I just think it scares me.
Okay. Now.
This is from Massimo. When I went to visit the winery, and he talked about the pre-phylloxera, and that the phylloxera doesn't go there; it dies when it goes. But when I was there, it were three types of rocks: so very small pebbles that came, and medium-sized and large ones. So the question really is, which one doesn't the phylloxera or the phylloxera die? When it goes into those, or cannot go into the store.
Alcuni sono collassate le alcune wineries.
You're talking about the wineries that collapsed, that closed down. You're referring to wineries that are closed.
I bet you know. I did to Massimo Settaro's winery, and he was the one I.
Massimo Settaro. He
showed me the soil. He picked up the right one. He showed me the whole thing. And I was interested in how that keeps the phylloxera from living there, that is, pre-phylloxera vines.
Massimo, una domanda per te. Massimo Settaro.
Yes, I'm not so sure to... I didn't understand as well. Puoi tradurmelo?
Okay.
Can you translate? Because I'm not so sure.
Era sui vigneti prefilossera, scusate se intendo io.
Okay. Grazie Gianluca.
Grazie. Yes. Yes. As I said, my winery is born towards some generation. My parents, my grandparents. So we was really focused on keeping our variety, like Caprettone or Piedirosso, that since 2,000 years ago, during the explosion of Vesuvio and Pompeii destruction, the poets spoke and wrote about this grape. So my goal, I was focused on this variety, and. We have ungrafted plants due to the soil, volcanic soil, and rich in minerals and really
Massimo, store the phylloxera can't reach the roots with the soil you have in the vineyards. So it's impossible that the phylloxera attack the roots,
yes.
Because the soil is
volcanic, it's like sandy but made by sandy and roots,
yeah, and so the phylloxera doesn't reach the roots.
Volcanic stone yeah. Volcanic sandy.
Charles, is that okay? Did it answer you?
Yeah.
Grazie Massimo. Some others?
Thank you.
No one? Okay.
No. Sorry, Marina. Yes. May I add just a consideration, just a point, a point of view on the pandemic approach. So we are approaching pandemia building a trustable relationship with distributor, with end customer. So it's very interesting build a relationship with the end customer. So now we are overcoming the pandemic crisis, building a proper relationship with end customer. So I think this is the only way to approach the big crisis, the current big crisis. So this is just our opinion.
Okay. Marina?
Okay.
Yes. Any other questions or?
Okay.
So. Okay.
So
I hope you can enjoy.
You enjoyed the tasting. Enjoy whatever is left of each single sample. I know it's small, but enjoy them. Okay. Some other questions? Nothing? Everything okay?
Yeah.
Are we open to any summary comments by tasters?
Where are you? What did I say? I'm Bill Marciano. Hi, Bill. Bill, did you try to say something?
Where is Bill Marciano?
È sotto. Ma non c'è la fotografia.
Okay.
Bill, we cannot hear you. No, he didn't.
Okay.
Oh. Hey, now?
Okay. No. Hi, Bill. Yes, there you are.
Okay. I was a little late to join you because I am a technosaur. But I had some wonderful experience with these wines.
Thank you.
I really liked the Tony because of the, as you say, the balanced oak, but the smoky notes in the taste were just wonderful. And the dense red color. The color was so red, it makes a ruby look like a window.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
The Cotarella Montiano, I think is seducente come un divano di peccato.
That's a nice way to describe it.
So. And also the Riserva Zeno, this is from what the Austrians call the Südtirol. They still call it the Südtirol, and they are still trying to make people believe that Beethoven was Austrian and Hitler was German. But it's really delightful, elegant wine.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And the Ipnotico is wonderfully persistent. So after you swallow, remember to lick your lips.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
And also Gutturnio, it was so nice to see Gutturnio back again. There are so many wines of Italy that should be present in the market. I'm thinking also of the wines of Sondrio, Rumello, Inferno, Sassella, Switzerland, and so on. But particularly Gutturnio, because it's right behind my ancestral region of Genoa.
Okay.
It's not far.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Goodbye. Thank you for being with us and joining
Goodbye,
us. And we look
you.
Forward
Bye.
To next time.
Bye.
Ciao. Bye.
Bye.
Ciao.
Ciao.
Ciao
a tutti. Ciao. 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 Ciao.